Listen to our podcast radio show, Hunt for Retirement, by visiting gwhunt.com. On this week's edition of Hunt for Retirement, we discuss securing lifetime income. Text HUNT to 555-888 or visit gwhunt.com to listen to the podcast now, or call 844-366-HUNT for a free copy of the book, Income Allocation, and a free retirement income report.
It might be time to rethink that Art Rooney statue. Yeah, you know, the one over at Heinz Field. And that Martin Luther King Memorial could be in trouble, too. Yesterday, right here on this very radio program, we spent a lot of time talking about the stupidity of the Yankees and then the Philadelphia Flyers when they decided to no longer use the recording of Kate Smith singing God Bless America at their games because the lyrics to a couple of songs that she did sing were racially insensitive. The Flyers actually released a statement saying that they are removing her statue from in front of the building. This is over a couple of songs she sang 80 years ago, as we pointed out yesterday. Well, Art Rooney founded the Steelers, and for the first, 13 years of the team's existence, there were no black players on the team. There were no black players in the NFL. And there is no man in Pittsburgh history who is more revered than the Chief. I knew him, and he's one of the nicest guys I've ever met, and he deserves a statue for being a nice guy, not for winning, and that's why it's there. But back in 1933, he was part of a gentleman's agreement to keep black players out of the NFL. He, of course, was a product of his times, and unless you were black, that wasn't even considered that outrageous at the time. It's just kind of the way things were. There were no black players in Major League Baseball or the NBA either back in the 1930s. But if you can justify removing a statue because of a song that a singer sang back in the 30s, how can you not justify either covering up or removing the statue of the Chief? And by the way, another guy who was involved in that gentleman's agreement, a guy named George Halas, he also has a statue in front of War Memorial Stadium in Chicago where the Bears play. He owned the Bears. He was one of the founders of the league. They kept blacks out for 13 years. Doesn't that statue just have to go? Come on. And by the way, Notre Dame had no black players under Newt Rockne. None. And his statue is still standing on the Notre Dame campus. He's revered. He's almost a sainted character on the new Notre Dame campus. No black players. They had no black students until 1947. And so there were no black players at Oklahoma under Bud Wilkinson. Guess what? He also has a statue. Now, what's worse, singing a song or refusing to allow black players in your league or on your team? I'll just let you think about that for a minute. I don't know what. I know it's difficult. But it's kind of subtle, but a lot of nuance there. But you, seriously, what's worse, singing a song, which, by the way, was also sung by Paul Robeson, a black entertainer and communist. He also sang that song, one of the songs that Kate Smith is being banned for. And then there's the Martin Luther King Memorial down there in Washington, and all those streets named after him. When he was asked for advice in a letter from a gay boy and how he should handle the fact that he feels attraction to other boys, Martin Luther King, Dr. Martin Luther King, the minister, he told the kid that homosexuality, in a letter now, so there's a record of it, he told the kid that homosexuality was a disorder and he needed to do things to help him break the habit. He called being homosexual a habit and used the word habit three times in the letter about how the kid should work hard to break his habit. He needed that habit to be broken. In 1965, or whenever that was, sometime around then, maybe a little earlier, that wasn't considered outrageous advice, really. In 2019, you know what that makes you? A homophobe. And apparently, under the current rules, sorry, no longer worthy of a statue. It's got to go. Or we can put a tarp over it. It would take a pretty big tarp, but it's got to go. You can't have a statue for a homophobe. And let's not limit it to statues and songs. Why is the American flag flying at Yankee Stadium tonight if they're playing there? Well, it's flying there all the time, but why is it flying there at the stadium anyway? Why is it flying at Heinz Field or any stadium? The country that Kate Smith honors with her song, America, allowed slavery for 75 years. That would seem to be a lot more offensive than a song, I think. A song? Singing a song? Or slavery for 75 years? I don't know. I think the slavery was worse. And why would the flag fly in any stadium or anywhere else after the country it represents had condoned slavery for all those years? It's offensive. And while we're at it, maybe it's time to start thinking of a new name for the country. You know, one that doesn't carry so much baggage. This United States thing. I mean, there's so many offensive things that go with it. And could someone please ask, while they're at it, so could someone ask Mayor Peduto? I'm not sure about this, but I would guess that he would say, if he was asked, that he agrees with what the Yankees did and what the Flyers did with Kate Smith. You know, ask him how he feels about the Art Rooney statue, which, by the way, I in no way want that to be taken anywhere. But just ask him how he feels about it, because he's the guy who was all for getting that evil Stephen Foster statue out of our sight several months ago. And that's finally gone. Meanwhile, when we come back, we're going to talk about the Equality Act and why it's another case of something with a really good name and a bad idea. Stick around. Have you heard the crack of the bat, the cheers of the crowd? Have you seen the smiles on the faces of the players as they take the field? I'm not talking about the Pirates. I'm talking about what's happening in Moon Township that can only be described as a miracle. This is John Steigerwald. With the help of Pirates Charities and people like yourself, the Miracle League of Moon Township has broken ground on a brand new ball field and adaptive playground where athletes with special needs can play regardless of their ability. At miraclesinmoon.org, you can see the stunning plans for the 9,500-square-foot playground and state-of-the-art ADA-compliant restroom facility with showers, wave technology, multi-level fountains and sinks, mechanical changing tables, and more. It's incredible. Our goal? To raise the remaining funds they need to bring it home by first pitch this September. Check it out at miraclesinmoon.org/donate and make your tax-deductible gift today. That's miraclesinmoon.org/donate. This message paid for by Robinson Town Center, a Zamias Properties entity. Obamacare, Trump Care, ACA, COBRA. There are so many choices, but all seem to bring one word to mind: expensive. There are lots of changes happening in healthcare today. Fortunately, I know someone that has been on the forefront of health insurance for years, Todd Marley at Marley Financial. Todd and his team of professionals are licensed with virtually every healthcare provider in the country. They help determine which plan is right for you and then expertly help you choose the best plan for your needs and then do so prudently. Don't need maternity coverage? Call Marley Financial. Have pre-existing conditions? Call Marley Financial. Want just catastrophic or just accident? You know the answer. Worried about the penalty? All of Marley Financial plans are penalty exempt because they know how to design the plans. Most of their clients save 30 to 60%, which can add up to several thousand dollars a year. Call Todd at Marley Financial, 724-884-1496. That's 724-884-1496 on the web at marleyfg.com.
Have you tried digital marketing but don't know if it's getting you customers? Got different companies running your web design, social media marketing, and geofencing, but not sure which is working and which is a waste of your dollars? Contact us at Salem Surround, digital marketing experts who offer a free analysis of your digital marketing effectiveness and suggest methods that could dramatically increase your sales. We can put all your digital marketing under one roof, give you monthly reports on results, and instantly move your dollars to the most effective areas of your digital marketing suite. Social marketing, geofencing, web search enhancement, event targeting, and more. Now there are no limitations on where you can reach customers with Salem Surround. Total market penetration for increased ROI. Learn more by logging on to surroundpittsburgh.com. Surroundpittsburgh.com. Connecting you with new customers.
Hi, we're the Goo Goo Dolls. We're fortunate that we can give our daughters everything they need to grow and learn, but not every child can focus on classes and play dates.
Nearly 13 million kids in the U.S. face hunger. That's one in six. School lunch might be their only meal each day, and it's heartbreaking to imagine any child going to bed hungry. We're dreaming of a perfect day when kids can smile, play, and just be kids without worrying about where their next meal will come from. Feeding America is working to make that perfect day a reality.
Each year, the Feeding America network of food banks rescues billions of pounds of good food that would have gone to waste. That food is given to families and children in need. Being a kid should be about doing things that make an ordinary day extraordinary. Learning to play an instrument, building a sandcastle, hosting tea parties. Hunger should never be an obstacle to growing up.
You can help end childhood hunger in your community by visiting feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
This is the John Steigerwald Show on AM 1250, The Answer.
Well, it's a long way until the election in 2020, 18 months, and that means that we are going to be exposed to a lot of stupidity. And that's it's a lot of it because there are a lot of candidates, and it's a long time, 18 months. And as far as I know, every Democrat in the House co-sponsored the Equality Act, and all but two Republicans said no. So how could anybody be against something called the Equality Act? That's kind of the point. It sounds wonderful, but it's not. Stella Morabito is a senior contributor at the Federalist. She says it undermines human freedoms and dignity by legally stripping Americans across the board of inalienable rights. She joins us now. Stella, thanks for being here.
Well, thanks for having me, John.
So how does something called the Equality Act do all that stuff to us?
Well, the same way any kind of bait and switch scam does that sort of thing. When I started off the article you're referring to, I said, put yourself in the mindset of a statist. I mean, if your goal was to consolidate power, how are you going to go about it? You're just going to tell people you've got this bait and later on you're going to switch it on them? No. It's not about equality. It's actually about inequality. And the inequality of power, as I'd put it, because it really just serves those who are the elites who can call all the shots, and those it purports to protect. I think once power is consolidated, which this bill, I mean, it is so bad. I mean, it is so coercive. It's not going to protect anybody.
Yeah, and you give five reasons why we should be against this bill. Number one is it undermines free speech. How does it do that?
Well, discrimination, the way it's been defined by the left and the power elites who run the left, they eliminate any kind of accommodation for conscience. So I think you have to go even before speech and freedom of thought, freedom of conscience, freedom of religion. And this bill explicitly states that the 1993 Religious Freedom Restoration Act that was overwhelmingly passed in Congress doesn't apply anymore, that there is no conscience protection. So, if you eliminate that, you've gone a long way to eliminating speech and discrimination, of course, all you have to do is look at the New York law that was passed a couple years ago, where a fine of about up to $250,000 could be levied against a business for, quote, misgendering someone. So, I mean, that, and it doesn't really state... Well, I guess it did state whether it's willful or not. But when you start getting the government in the business of parsing your thoughts, reading your mind, interpreting even maybe a tone of voice or a raised eyebrow or whatever, that can be construed as discrimination.
Of course, when you call something the Equality Act, and only two Republicans have signed on to, at least the last I looked, it was all the Democrats and two Republicans signed, and no other Republicans signed on to it. At this point, it's co-sponsoring. And it hasn't been actually presented as a bill and been voted on yet. But the point is, they are going, when you have something and you call it the Equality Act, people aren't going to spend the time to do what you did and break it down and analyze it and look at all the things, all the dangers within it. Most people are going to say, the Republicans are against equality. This is the Equality Act. How could you be against that? Isn't that part of the evil of this thing?
Sure, yeah. I mean, that's the branding part of it, the baiting, the lure. There's always got to be a lure so that people feel if they don't go along with it, they're going to be smeared as bigots or haters or whatever. But part of the problem is the growing ignorance or the inability of people to think things through because their education system certainly not valued independent thought. And so we've got a whole generation of more than one generation not really able to see these things and to be, educated as a voter or as someone who looks at issues and thinks critically about them. So, yeah, I mean, I don't know what the answer is to that, but, you know, it's really insidious, Bill. I mean, if you look at the ambiguity of the language in it, where it starts focusing on gender identity. Well, the whole purpose of this bill, by the way, for your listeners, is to take all of the non-discrimination acts on the federal level. There's already been a lot of this done on state and local level, but the point of it is to take all of these, including especially the 1964 Civil Rights Act, but all of the other, all of the other non-discrimination legislation that's been passed federally, and to include or inject into those laws the term sexual orientation and gender identity, abbreviated as SOGI, S-O-G-I. And these SOGI laws, have already been, for the past 10 years or more even, passed on municipal and state levels. And so the idea is to give it a blanket federal, force of federal law. Nancy Pelosi said that this was going to be like a signature piece of legislation, this Congress. So, but it's filled with all kinds of ambiguities. Like, gender identity, they have the definition of it as the gender-related identity, appearance, mannerisms, or other gender-related characteristics of an individual, regardless of the individual's designated sex at birth. A lot of these laws will say sex assigned at birth.
Mm-hmm.
Either way.
What's the difference?
There really isn't.
Who's assigning and designating it?
Well, I think they went for the term designated because it maybe has a little less of the implication of an arbitrary, like the doctor just kind of arbitrarily said, this is a boy, this is a girl, so I will assign you this sex based on genitalia. That's a complaint of the transgender lobby. But what that does, what that phraseology does is it makes us all transgender. It basically, it's a premise that's embedded in the law that applies universally. Basically, everybody's sex is, quote, assigned at birth or designated at birth, according to laws like this. I mean, the devil's in the details, and this is really insidious stuff. Anyway, I don't want to...
Your piece is great. We're talking to Stella Morabito of The Federalist, and you should check this out at thefederalist.com. Because you really break it down and you explain this very well, and it's really scary when you see it. And that's why I wanted to have you on to explain as much as you could. And I realize it's a lot for only 15 minutes. But this has happened so fast that it does. I mean, how long have we even been supposed to be in agreement that gender is something you decide that you are, or sex you decide that you are, and it's not what you actually are, it's what you want to be? I mean, it's gotten to the point now where we have every Democrat in the House is buying into that whole idea, the whole idea of gender identity. We're doomed.
Well, no, not so fast. but yeah, I mean, it is really, it's really bad when you look back. The groundwork was laid for a long, long time. I mean, this wouldn't happen out of the blue in a, in a nation in which all of the students in the schools and universities were encouraged to think their own thoughts and encouraged to have free inquiry. It really came about over the past couple of generations. You can actually trace it back 100 years to the Frankfurt School and cultural Marxism and, which really birthed identity politics and political correctness. And, people are so scared to death of being socially isolated, socially rejected. I believe that that's really the fuel that pushes.
Yeah, it's not it's not just whether you if you disagree, you don't just disagree, you're a bad person. If you
exactly.
want to be a good person, you must agree with me. Because if you don't, that automatically makes you a bad person. You talk about that you say that the government might someday have the power to de-sex us, regardless of the individual's designated sex at birth. That's a pretty scary concept.
Well, that's the word, the term I came up with. I actually, a couple of years ago, I wrote a piece for Public Discourse in which I talk about how the language we are being de-sexed. I mean, like I said, the premise, sex assigned at birth, applies universally. It means that you are only male because you think you're male, and I'm only female because I think I'm female. And, of course, that has huge ramifications for the legal status of family relationships. We may not see it that much now, although it's coming. It has ramifications for, it's very dehumanizing.
Well, if there's no more male-female, there's no more mother-father distinctions. That's the way you put it.
Right. Or son, daughter.
Right.
Yeah. And the biological, it's an attack, as a war on biology as well. And so the biological relationship or the bond that's there naturally is it's as though it's being attacked in law by legislation like this. And, it sets us up for the whole system of punishment and rewards, which is what you get with the political correctness that threatens social isolation if you don't get with the program, which is why they use terms like equality and social justice. Gee, who could be against that?
Mm-hmm.
And so, it's almost as though, and I mentioned this in the piece, being nudged into a social credit system like China has. I don't know if your listeners are familiar with China's social credit system now, but your compliance with the communist line or the government is... you get actual scores on that social credit, and that will affect your access to housing, education,
pretty scary.
Services, goods, and that's happening now in China.
I know.
And so we have legislation like this that really sets up a system by which the elite can reward or punish those who comply or fall out of compliance with their idea of, this utopia, dystopia.
Hey, Stella, I'm up against a hard break. I have about 20 seconds. I just have time to thank you for being here. And as I said, 15 minutes wasn't enough, but thanks for being here. We'll do it again.
Thanks so much.
Okay, that's Stella Morabito, and that is just an unbelievably scary thing rolling down the track. You wonder if it can be stopped. We'll be back.
With SRN News, I'm Keith Peters in Washington. A majority on the Supreme Court appear to be okay with a citizenship question on the 2020 census, despite objections from left-wing organizations and three lower court rulings. Correspondent Mark Sherman reports on why this ruling is so important.
The results of the census will help determine the allocation of seats in the House of Representatives among the states as well as the allocation of billions of dollars in federal money over the next 10 years.
The Supreme Court heard arguments today. A record day on Wall Street as both the S&P 500 and NASDAQ indexes closed at record highs. The market has risen sharply since bottoming out on Christmas Eve, driven by greater confidence in the economy and reassurances that the Federal Reserve is unlikely to raise interest rates this year. The Dow Jones Industrial Average closed up 145 points to 26,656. This is SRN News.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans. 30% of Americans who are planning home improvements of $5,000 or more will pay for those renovations with a high-interest credit card. That may not be a great idea. A better idea may be to take cash out of your home with a Quicken Loans 30-year fixed-rate mortgage. The rate today on our 30-year fixed-rate mortgage is 4.5%, APR 4.78%. Call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com.
Rate subject to change. Pay 2% fee, receive this discounted rate. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. License in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.
When it comes to your pain, many of you might be skeptical, like I was, about ordering Relief Factor. Pat Boone again for this wonderful 100% drug-free supplement designed to help your own body lower or eliminate occasional aches and pains due to aging, exercise, everyday living. I'm not skeptical any longer. The three-week quick start is now discounted to only $19.95. Why don't you let us see if we can get you out of pain, too, at ReliefFactor.com.
Dennis Prager explains his opposition to mass immigration.
The answer is they bring un-American values.
They're not bad people.
The biggest one of the un-American values is they bring belief in big government. That's it. And big government will destroy the American story, the American dream, the American ideal, the American hope.
The Dennis Prager Show, weekdays at noon, right before Sebastian Gorka at 3 on AM 1250. The Answer.
Hunt & Associates is your resource for examining the important financial aspects for your retirement plan. Listen to our podcast radio show, Hunt for Retirement, by visiting gwhunt.com. On this week's edition of Hunt for Retirement, we discuss securing lifetime income. Text HUNT to 555-888 or visit gwhunt.com to listen to the podcast now or call 844-366-HUNT for a free copy of the book, Income Allocation, and a free retirement income report.
You're an insurance agent. You're also an entrepreneur looking to grow. And what better way to grow than by being your own boss? Owning your own Farmers Insurance Agency has been called one of the best small business opportunities in America. With a nationally respected brand, award-winning training, and your personal experienced business coach, your opportunity to grow is unlimited. No franchise fees required. Visit BeAFarmersAgent.com and start growing.
We are farmers. Bum, 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 bum.
Hurt in an accident? I can't help you. But if you've invented a new product, improved an existing device, or need help registering a trademark, call me, attorney Gary Topolowski, at 877-5-PATENT. I've been helping clients protect their ideas for nearly 35 years. Email me at patentlawyerpittsburgh.com. Ask about my discounts for veterans and seniors. 877-572-8368. Now's the time to pursue your dreams, but let's protect them first.
Are you tired of your old and drafty windows and doors? Pella offers three lines of vinyl, a fiberglass product, and various lines of wood. So we have gorgeous new windows and doors to fit your needs and any budget. You deserve Pella quality. And for a limited time, get 50% off installation and 12 months no payments, no interest. Yeah, we can do that. Call 855-77-PELLA. We'll come to you. PellaPittsburgh.com.
Stuck in traffic? We've got the answer.
It's stop and go on the Parkway West inbound. The business loop past Steubenville Pike, then Green Tree to the Fort Pitt Tunnel. Outbound Banksville Road to Green Tree, then 79 to Steubenville Pike. Parkway East inbound jams 2nd Avenue to the Fort Pitt Bridge. Outbound Oakland out to Edgewood Swissvale. On 28, you're jammed in both directions approaching the Highland Park Bridge. Crosstown Boulevard outbound, that's jamming Bigelow Boulevard to the Parkway North. Heads up in Stowe, a crash Island Avenue near Municipal Street. Some jam traffic there. I'm Brendan Joseph. That's a look at traffic.
AM 1250, The Answer. Weather.
A shower or thunderstorm will be in the area through the early part of this evening. In clearing skies later tonight, breezy with a low of 44. Mostly sunny tomorrow with a high of 65 degrees. Partly cloudy tomorrow night, low 46. And for Thursday, mostly cloudy. A little bit of rain will be developing during the afternoon hours. High Thursday, 67 degrees. With your Racky weather forecast, I'm meteorologist Danielle Niddle.
You're listening to the John Steigerwald Show on AM 1250, The Answer.
Well, it's hard to imagine, as I said a few minutes ago, the overwhelming amount of stupidity that we're going to be exposed to by the Democrats between now and November of 2020. There are so many of them out there, and there are 18 months left and more candidates coming. Elizabeth Warren can be counted on for a lot of that stupidity. Last night, I think it was last night, she promised to eliminate college debt and make college free for everybody. Who wouldn't be for that, especially if you're 16 and they let you vote? Well, Mary Clare Amselem is a policy analyst at the Heritage Foundation. She joins us now. Mary Clare, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
So, Senator Warren says we can have free college and make it retroactive by forgiving student debt. Why would anybody be against that?
Yeah, it's quite an expensive undertaking. So she's proposing a $1.25 trillion plan to erase student loan debt for people making under $100,000 a year and to erase part of the debt for students making between $100,000 and $250,000 a year. So it's quite an expensive program that does nothing to address the drivers of college tuition, which is, quite frankly, the involvement of the federal government in our student loan system.
Yeah, I'll get to that in a second. But the interesting thing about it, which I looked at her plan, and as you said, if you make more than $100,000, you're probably not going to get your debt taken care of. But if which means that, and if you make over 250, you don't get anything. So you don't get the benefits of this. So if you have, say, you're a family with making $250,000 a year, and you have two kids in college, and you're paying $30,000 a year for each of them for 4 years, you get nothing. And not only that, but your taxes will go to pay for the people who are getting something. Correct?
Exactly. So she's proposing to pay for this by a tax on the super wealthy, which is a pot of money she's already promised to cover her proposal for free child care for all Americans. So she's double dipping it in the pot here for how we're going to pay this off. But I think you're exactly right to point out that, you know, if a family making $250,000 a year can have quite a few other expenses in addition to their student loan debts, and now it's proposed that they're going to be paying off the loans for other Americans. At the end of the day, students who took on these loans did sign a contract to pay it back, and American taxpayers are going to be left in the lurch for this. A better solution is to lower college tuition by getting the federal government out of the game.
Now, how does the federal government being in the game affect the cost of tuition, and how does it get out, and then what happens? How does the cost go down?
Yeah, so the federal government controls 90% of all loans that are out there. So we've nearly nationalized the student loan system. And evidence has suggested that because of this easy access to federal loans that students have, the colleges have been encouraged to raise their tuition prices, confident that the federal government will come in and help out students who aren't able to make up that difference when schools do raise their tuition. The Federal Reserve Bank of New York came out with a study a few years ago that showed that for every dollar that an institution receives in federal funds, colleges raise their tuition by about 60 cents. And so this explains why we've seen tuition skyrocket in recent decades, because the federal government has increased the amount of loans that they're putting into the system. And so if we want to alleviate student debt and make college more affordable for Americans, we need to insert the private lending market into the system and get the federal government to take a step back and reduce tuition inflation.
Yeah, I've thought that for a long time. It seems like such an obvious thing that you see the government make money available in loans, and you see the tremendous increase in costs, much higher than the rate of inflation for college tuition, and it's just amazing to me that more people don't put that together and figure out one is the cause and one is the effect.
Absolutely. It seems very common sense, but unfortunately, instead of policymakers admitting that the federal government's involvement in higher education has been disastrous for taxpayers and for college tuition, we see many on the left doubling down and saying, no, we're going to involve the federal government even more, but we're going to remove all cost of attendance for students and transfer that all into American taxpayers while the cost of tuition is going upwards. And so college is only going to get more expensive under free college proposals, but Americans are going to have to be picking up the tab, two-thirds of whom don't have college degrees. And so to have the two-thirds of Americans paying for the one-third of Americans who do have a college degree doesn't seem like the equitable solution that Senator Warren purports it is.
Well, I was going to college back almost in the, you know, back in the 20th century. And people used to look at the cost of the school, and they would say, I can afford it or I can't. And the parents would say, you know, it's nice that you can, your grades are good enough to go to a University X, but the tuition there is higher than we can afford. So we're going to try to get some aid. We'll see what we can do. But you might have to get a job and put yourself through college. You know, I mean, there wasn't somebody there handing you money. And if they did hand you money, you knew you had to pay it back. It seemed to work okay. How did we get to this point?
Well, this plan to eliminate student loan debt for many students is sort of a slap in the face for many students who were in a scenario like you just mentioned, who either decided not to attend college because they did a cost-benefit analysis and it didn't work out for them, or they chose to live very modest lifestyles and making monthly payments and paying off their loans and living fiscally responsible lives. That it's sort of a slap in the face for students who were leading that way. If you were, let's say, delinquent on your loans for months and months and months, and then you just get that balance wiped away. My husband and I, for example, just paid quite a bit on our student loans. If student loan debt gets wiped away tomorrow, do we get that money back? No, not necessarily. And so it's not a responsible way that we should be handling our student loan debt crisis. As I mentioned before, we should be addressing how we got here and working on solutions to lowering college costs.
Well, why wouldn't you and your husband, if you see this this wonderful plan coming down the track that you're going to get your debt forgiven, why would you and your husband or anybody else like you not, you know, let's put this off. We owe, you know, $40,000. Why don't we just hold off on that a little bit, and maybe in a couple of years we won't owe anything?
I think that's exactly right, and I think that many Americans are doing that. I think many are going delinquent on their loans. I think as much as 40%, I've seen some figures say that 40% of student loans are in delinquency. This is quite a bit of a problem for American taxpayers because the schools have already been paid. The schools are making out, you know, grants in this scenario. They've been paid by taxpayers. It's the American people who aren't getting paid back, which is why we're seeing our country plunge into further debt. I think that the wrong solution is to put more money on the credit card of the American people. I think that we need to have colleges step up and lower their tuition prices. To let more students be able to actually afford this out of their own pockets.
I think Elizabeth Warren made somewhere between $375,000 I've seen and $429,000 I just saw today. I don't know if that's true, but I've seen the $375,000 figure many times for teaching at Harvard. Do you think her friends that are still teaching there would be okay with massive pay cuts to lower the tuition? Because I kind of doubt it.
Yeah, I agree. I think that would be probably an unpopular proposal. But, you know, for a lot of this money going to these universities, a lot of it isn't even going to teacher salaries. It's going to administrators. We have a massive administrative blow problem going on college campuses. But schools have been able to increase their number of administrators, you know, tenfold because of the amount of money going into these institutions. So, again, if we want to encourage, you know, good behavior on the part of universities, which is producing a good academic product, keeping their tuition prices low, we need to remove the guarantee of federal money from universities that we have today.
We're talking to Mary Clare Amselem. She's a policy analyst at the Heritage Foundation. Now, why is it, Mary Clare, do you suppose, I don't expect you to actually have an answer to this, but it's just interesting to me, liberals who are always so vigilant when it comes to exposing, you know, businesses that take advantage of consumers by overcharging for their products, they never seem to have a problem or put pressure on the colleges who are, I mean, I don't know if there is a product out there, a widely used product out there that has increased at the rate that college tuition has in the last, I don't know, 15, 20 years.
I think you're right to point that out. And, you know, colleges should be held accountable for the product that they're producing. I think that our policymakers tend to approach higher education with kid gloves and put it in this, you know, protected space in society. But something as important as education should be looked at with a magnifying glass, especially given the heavy financial investment that we're putting into these institutions. And so I think we do need to be looking at colleges and demanding that they produce the high-quality product for the money that we're giving them. And I think that if we want to insulate taxpayers from the bad behavior on part of universities, we definitely need to privatize the student loan system so that the relationship is between the student and the university and leave the third party out of it.
Again, like everything else, though, in a situation like this, if you are the Democrats, you say you're in favor of free college, you're in favor of the student loan program and the government being involved, so it puts the Republicans or anybody who opposes them in the position of being opposed to college education or not thinking that poor people should be have the right to go to college. That's the way it's going to be presented.
And I think that's an unfortunate framing. And I think we're rather short-sighted in the way that we view options after high school in our country today. I mean, we're hearing from politicians that if you want to achieve the American dream, you have to go to a four-year university and obtain a bachelor's degree. I think that's remarkably limited. I think we should have multiple options for students after high school and many streamlined options that get you exactly to where you want to go in your career. You know, if you want to be a doctor, you don't necessarily need to take literature courses. Literature
Right.
courses are great for expanding your mind and becoming a well-rounded person. But if the biggest financial risk of your life is going to college, then, you know, maybe you can do that later in life, or maybe you can do that on your own. We deserve to have options for students that get you from point A to point B in the fastest way possible and as cheaply as possible.
There's also... Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say that unfortunately those options don't exist in America today, and we're hearing from policymakers that you shouldn't have that option, that you should go through this very convoluted bachelor's degree system, and I think that that's unfortunate.
There's also a movement out there to make colleges reveal their records in producing people who then go on to benefit from the degree that they paid so much money for. Is there any chance of that becoming a reality? As long as you want to have control and you're with the government, you know, why not make the colleges who are charging this money show the benefits of what are waiting for you when you graduate with a degree in gender studies, you know?
That data at some level is out there. I mean, we do have the college scorecard, which shows, you know, graduation rates and things like that. But that program level data, what you are referring to, you know, how much does someone who pursues this degree, how much do they make, you know, 5-10 years after graduation? That's information the universities probably have but aren't making readily available. A way around that is something called an income share agreement. So this is something that Purdue University is doing.
Mm-hmm.
And so a student pays, the concept behind an income share agreement is that a student pays nothing up front, but then they agree to pay a percentage of their future earnings after graduation. And so the school is heavily incentivized to make sure, okay, you're a high earner after you graduate because we want a bigger, you know, piece of your earnings.
Yeah, but it still comes down to Mary Claire. If you're going through all those, if you're going through all that to make it affordable, then it just means your costs are you're too expensive. It shouldn't have to be that complicated.
I agree entirely, which is why all of our conversations around higher ed should be getting to the root causes of tuition inflation and reversing that. And I think economists are pretty much in agreement that the causes of tuition inflation are the federal government's involvement in higher education.
Now, you wrote a piece for Heritage about California and free community college. Lots of problems there. And is that just a kind of a precursor to what would happen if it went federal?
Exactly. I think a lot of the discussions in the states around free college right now are starting at the community college level. And I think you're exactly right. These problems will only be, you know, exacerbated if made at the federal level. And what I've always said about community college, free community college, is that it turns our K-12 system into a K-14 system. And if we expand that into 4 years of college, then we're simply, you know, watering down our years of education, where what we should be doing is getting students to their careers faster rather than having them waste more years in school.
And if the free college and debt forgiveness were put to a vote in the House tomorrow, it would pass. And if the Republicans lose the Senate, how does this not become a reality? I only have about 30 seconds left here.
Well, whether or not, you know, votes on that, you know, I can't say. I can only speculate. But, you know, I think that many Americans are smart, and they know that when you say free college, that is not necessarily free. That someone has to pay for it, and it's something that we can't afford right now.
Mary Claire, thank you very much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
I appreciate it. We'll have you back again. Thanks. That's Mary Claire Amselem. She's a policy analyst at the Heritage Foundation. She just hung up her phone, and I'll be right back.
And I never go.
Have you heard the crack of the bat, the cheers of the crowd? Have you seen the smiles on the faces of the players as they take the field? I'm not talking about the Pirates. I'm talking about what's happening in Moon Township that can only be described as a miracle. This is John Steigerwald. With the help of Pirates Charities and people like yourself, the Miracle League of Moon Township has broken ground on a brand new ball field and adaptive playground where athletes with special needs can play regardless of their ability. At miraclesinmoon.org, you can see the stunning plans for the 9,500-square-foot playground and state-of-the-art ADA-compliant restroom facility with showers, wave technology, multi-level fountains and sinks, mechanical changing tables, and more. It's incredible. Our goal? To raise the remaining funds they need to bring it home by first pitch this September. Check it out at miraclesinmoon.org/donate and make your tax-deductible gift today. That's miraclesinmoon.org/donate. This message paid for by Robinson Town Center, a Zamias Properties entity.
Are you about to pay double for roof replacement or repair? If you haven't called Windows or Us, you just might. Many companies are overcharging area homes and businesses nearly double. With over 50 years in home remodeling, Windows R Us is more than a window company. They're the area's premier exterior replacement company for siding, doors, gutters, downspouts, and roof replacement and repair. Factory certified by North America's largest roof manufacturer, Windows R Us will never overcharge. You'll love their no-pressure sales approach, straightforward pricing, and the fastest turnaround in the business. Right now, get zero interest for 12 months on up to $20,000. Windows R Us will match any competitor's price. No hidden fees or surprises ever. Schedule a free roof inspection today. Mention AM1250 for an exclusive 10% off. Why pay double? Visit the area's premier exterior replacement company. Windows R Us, more than a window company. Visit WindowsRUsPittsburgh.com.
Hey, I'm Andy. If you don't know me, it's probably because I'm not famous. But I did start a men's grooming company called Harry's. The idea for Harry's came out of a frustrating experience I had buying razor blades. Most brands were overpriced, overdesigned, and out of touch. At Harry's, our approach is simple. Here's our secret. We make sharp, durable blades and sell them at honest prices for as low as $2 each. We care about quality so much that we do some crazy things, like buy a world-class German blade factory. Obsessing over every detail means we're confident in offering a 100% quality guarantee. Millions of guys have already made the switch to Harry's, so thank you if you're one of them. And if you're not, we hope you give us a try with this special offer. Get a Harry starter set with a 5-blade razor, weighted handle, shave gel, and a travel cover. All for just $3 plus free shipping. Just go to harrys.com and enter 3366 at checkout. That's harrys.com, code 3366. Enjoy.
Getting close to retirement? Experienced a nice Trumponomics bump in your portfolio? Well, we know the market goes up, and unfortunately, we also know it goes down. Don't risk your retirement to market whims. Learn how you can lock in those gains today by spending time with the team at Marley Financial. Todd Marley and the experts at Marley Financial can help you design a retirement plan that is bulletproof against the market's ups and downs. The team at Marley Financial uses a multitude of different techniques to make sure that you have a retirement plan that is tax-friendly, stable, and worry-free. Oh, speaking of taxes, did you know that Marley Financial can handle that too? With all the changes in the tax laws, be sure you're taking advantage of the best possible deduction and make sure you know what adjustments to make for your overall financial picture going forward. Call today for a no-obligation consultation to see just how for 25 years the clients at Marley Financial have never had a retirement plan fail. Call 724-884-1496 today, 724-884-1496, or visit them at marleyfg.com.
This is the John Steigerwald Show on AM 1250 and FM 92.5. The Answer.
Well, as long as we were talking about college, let's pick up on that thing. We spent a lot of time talking about education here and the stupidity on college campuses. I saw this the other day. I wanted to get a chance to mention it. A student newspaper editorial board endorses non-white segregated housing. That's at Williams College, actually. The editorial board of a campus newspaper has endorsed a proposal to establish segregated housing on campus, claiming that such housing will help make the school safe and welcoming. It's the Coalition Against Racist Education Now. It's a coalition of activist students at Williams College, and they released a list of demands, calling upon the college trustees to fulfill their obligation to the well-being and safety of its students, faculty, and staff. This is what the board went on to say. And it wholeheartedly supports establishing this housing at the college. As a community, we must recognize that the college is a predominantly white institution in which students of color often feel tokenized, both in their residences and more broadly on campus. Establishing affinity housing will not single-handedly solve this problem, but it will assist in making the college a more welcoming, supportive, and safe community for minoritized students. Some say this housing reinforces division, arguing that having minoritized students cluster in one space would be harmful to the broader campus community. We believe, however, that allowing for a space where students can express their identities without fear of tokenization or marginalization will encourage students to exist more freely in the broader campus community rather than recede from it. And I have a solution for this. It's called an all-black college. If you don't want to feel marginalized, you don't want to be a minority, and you don't go to a college that's mixed races and then say you want to be segregated. There's plenty of schools out there. Just go to an all-black school. And you're supposed to go to college to get smarter, aren't you? Not dumber. This is unbelievably stupid. And it probably costs about $80,000 a year to go there. But I'm going to say 60, maybe. I'll see you tomorrow. Bye.
The John Steigerwald Show is a production of AM 1250, The Answer, and Salem Media Group.
Hurt in an accident? I can't help you. But if you've invented a new product, improved an existing device, or need